Welcome everybody to season whatever this is of the Underbelly Hours, new and improved.
This is correct.
It's been some time, folks.
It has.
A lot has happened.
Too much, I'd argue, has happened. But one thing that is good is we've returned to help you guys stay sane, to help ourselves stay sane in the mess that's happened and everything that's going to happen.
And a lot of new music has come out.
That's true.
A lot of our favorite artists and new, newly found artists have put out some great stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to be trying to just get the best of the best.
That's right.
This season.
On this season, we're also going to include video footage, clips. We're going to have behind the scenes content. We're going to have really good interviews with local artists and even more fun stuff that's going to be released as the season unfolds. But for now,
without further ado,
I'm Adela.
And I'm Dan.
And you're listening to The Underbelly Hours.
In my basement.
Take off your coat and stay a while!
Like listening to new music? Want to know a band before they get popular? Tune into The Underbelly Hours, Sunday nights at 6 p.m. on WRSC 88.7 FM, and discover the best of local unsigned musicians. Don't miss out on the next big thing.
All right, so before we get into our first interview of the season, which of course has to be none other than Pino Farina.
That's right.
Of the Pino Farina band.
Yeah, a really, really great guy, fantastic
guy.
Musician, and somebody who's been doing a lot of live streams and super active.
He's been kicking all the ass.
In 2020, which is saying something.
Yes.
Right?
He's been able
there was
to...
very little ass to kick in 2020, but he did it still.
He still found all the ass, and he kicked it.
That's right.
Good kicks. Good kicks. Solid kicks. Bruising kicks.
Okay.
And, but before we get to that a lovely interview, we got some new music that we want to highlight, you know? We gotta give the shout-outs to the new music.
We do.
So, first off.
First off.
What are we starting with, Adela?
I want to start with a song, a single by Milo the Generation Hero. She's released another track that's going to be coming off her AIP Elevation album that's coming out soon. It was supposed to release in 2020, but there was technical difficulties, all this other stuff. So she's chosen to delay the release for a little bit, but I'm glad that she decided to release the single as a teaser because it just made me more hype for the album that she's about to drop. It's called Grind and Shine. It's got a simple beat and a simple melody, but because of that, I just feel like it really gets you hype. I don't know. It's really positive. It's got a really positive message, and I love her rap style because she almost has like these Milo mantras, right? She has this phrase that she uses to get you super, super pumped up. So for AIP, it was anything is possible, right? And that was kind of the mantra of the song that you just kept like kind of shouting to yourself as the song was going. For Grind and Shine, it's grind and shine. Now is our time. And I just keep that, like, it's such a fun little phrase that like keeps repeating throughout the song. And I just can't help but like kind of bop my head to it. And it's the type of song I want to wake up to on mornings where I just don't feel any motivation, you know? Mm-hmm. Grind and shine. Mm-hmm. So here it is, the newest single by Milo, the Generation Hero.
Yeah. Yeah. Grind, grind, grind. Say shine, shine, shine.
I say grind and shine. Now it's my time. I say grind and shine. Now it's my time, I say grind and shine. Now it's my time, I'm thankful to be alive. So I'ma grind and shine, I say grind and shine. Cause now it's my time, I say grind and shine. Cause now it's my time, I say grind and shine. Cause now it's my time, I'm so thankful to be alive. So I'ma grind and shine. All this negativity, I'm all about the energy. Unk told me to go harder, put more passion in my delivery. Forget about the beef, get some cheese like a chef. If you don't listen to your inner voice, you grind and you deaf. Listen and I make conscious observations. Y'all very impatient, why y'all study hating? You spoil old rappers, it's very outdated. I'm on the rise, you can call me elevated. Flow steady, switching up like a stick shift. gear. You can deny me all you want, all my time is quite near. Flow is so gentle, I go mental on the beat. Metaphors is worth millions, cause my talk is never cheap. I always ball out, check my stats, no fumble. Coming for Milo, I'll leave you in trouble. Never arrogant, I just learned to be humble. When I am what I am, let me be like a bubble. Grant and shine, now it's my time. I say grant and shine. Now it's my time, I say grand and shine. Now it's my time, I'm thankful to be alive. So I'm a grand and shine, I say grand and shine. Cause now it's my time, I say grand and shine. Cause now it's my time, I say grand and shine. Cause now it's my time, I'm so thankful to be alive. So I'm a grand and shine. Thinking about the past as I'm living in the present. Girl turned to a goddess from a peasant. Damn, it's a blessing. Damn, I'm so impressing. If you get harsh, you for the stars is my suggestion. Cloudy in the past, but it's sunny in the future. Don't listen to rumors. Success is coming sooner. Flow is so cancerous. Yes, I spit that tumor. I go overboard and I'm not talking about a Hoover. Stab me in my back and I bet I eat that knife. Big blunts of the natural ice. Damn, my daddy got natural life. I'm shooting for the Milky Way. There is no limit. I'm not scared. Ain't no bone in my body timid. Man on this money and this money on my mind. Every day is Thanksgiving. I'm thankful to be alive. I'm a grand and shine.
Now, bam, here's where to bam. Bam, we're back. Shabam, kablow, kabam.
That was, again, Grand and Shine by Milo, the Generation Hero. Another new music we want to highlight, Dan, is who?
Are we shouting out the one and only?
I think so. I think it's time. Mirabelle.
Skipworth.
Skipworth. Woo! She's great. She's
worth a skip. Sure, she's never gotten that before.
She's great. Her new album is, what is it? Postcards from Patmos.
Actually, that would be really bad. It's not worth a skip.
No, it's.
I meant like a worth a skip, like a ha. Right, and then I retroactively was like, oh, that could be taken as like worth a skip, like
a skip on your playlist.
Next.
Absolutely not. No.
Sorry, Mirabelle. I'm an idiot.
Well,
as you well know.
Mirabelle has released a new track, or new track.
A new concept album.
Called Postcards from Patmos, which absolutely slaps. It's really good. I don't know if slaps
is
a good word.
That's one way of putting it. I don't know if slaps would be the right adjective or turn of phrase
or slang. It's not like very fast-paced or,
I mean, she's a folk artist, so I think it's... I mean, when I hear it slaps.
Yeah, that's right. Maybe that's not the right word, but like, anyways. It's wonderful.
It's a wonderful journey.
It
has a lot of depth and
gravity.
Gravitas, if I may say so myself. But it has a really cool
story
because it's all based from based on the mm-hmm. book of Revelation.
Mm-hmm.
So it gets a little intense maybe at times because, you know, there's
talk about like, you know, God, there's talk about,
I mean, it's the end of times.
End of times. There's talk about,
like, but it's more uplifting than,
yeah, yeah.
It's not,
well,
like,
but there's
fire
there's,
and brimstone.
There's like, I think there's a lot of deep diving into like, what is your intent? Like, what is your purpose? What is your nature here?
Yes.
And what's the nature of good and evil? Which
right.
is so cool. And
very
she
cool.
does it while being melodious, while being very, just her melodies are always great, and her instrumentals are wonderful too. She collaborates with some fantastic musicians to really piece it together. What song, though, should we shout out off of this? Because all of them are so great.
The Lion, Ox, Man, and Eagle.
That's
really
good.
Mm-hmm. I like that one. That might be a good one. Or the horses in there.
Let's
but that's all new. It doesn't matter. We're not on radio.
That's true.
We can play.
Let's do the horses.
We can play
in
a 10-minute, you know, guitar solo.
That's true. This is not a 10-minute guitar solo.
No.
But this is, in fact, The Horses and Their Men by
Mirabelle Skipworth on the Underbelly Hours.
Boom, boom, boom.
In my basement.
So that was The Horses and Their Men by Mirabelle Scopeff. Once again, check out her latest album, Postcards from Patmos. It is 100% worth your time. Yes. Without further ado, let's move on to the next section of the Underbelly Hours with our one and only featured guest. Substance.
Pino Farina. All right.
Okay.
Welcome to the interview section of the podcast.
That's correct. Today we have with us somebody who's been on the show already a couple of times. He's a great human being, a wonderful musician, and seriously one of the best singers I think we've had on the show. His name is Pino Farina, and we're so happy to have you back, Pino. Welcome back to the show.
Wow, well, quite an introduction. Thank you so much for having me. Has it been two times already that I've been with you guys on the show?
I think so.
This is the third time, I think, because the first time was back right when...
I don't even think I was on the show, was I?
No, you were.
I was?
That's remember when Jonathan was playing...
And he busted his finger.
He busted his finger. That was pretty cool.
Right.
He played so hard that he bled. That was so rock and roll.
The new season, it's an honor to be a part of the first episode of the new season. So that's awesome.
Well,
for sure.
I don't think anyone more deserved of our season premiere than Pino. He has been kicking ass in the quarantine live stream scene.
That's very true.
And yeah, you've just been hauling ass and.
I've been busy. You know what it is I just love playing, you know, and it's like, ain't nothing going to stop me kind of feeling, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I was talking to somebody else who streams a bit too. Her name's Gina Gonzalez. She's also like another streamer. And, you know, back in March, she was like, I just need to do it to keep my chops up, you know? You're playing almost every week, playing live gigs, and then all of a sudden, bam, like nobody can play anymore. And it's like, well, if you just stop, you kind of like lose that muscle a little bit, or you lose that like part of, you know. So mm-hmm. I think it was just like keeping the momentum going as a musician, a performer, not so much the songwriter or like whatever other aspect, but just as performance, and just keep your chops up, keep that muscle going, and just, you know, just keep doing what you love doing, you know. So that's where it started from.
Mm-hmm. For sure. I think let's go into this a little bit more in a little bit, because we definitely have a section talking dedicated to live streaming in a little bit.
Of course.
But
we have to start with an icebreaker game, even though the ice has been broken.
The ice has been broken with Pino.
But we still love to play stupid games.
That's true.
Open up the interview with some stupid games. And we have a new game that you were not on the show before we came up with this. So
okay.
We're gonna give you the fair share of this.
Basically, guys.
Josh, cut this.
Basically, so Pino's been on the show. This is the third time, right? We've talked a lot about his like influences and done a few of these other games before with him. So you can go back and listen to those if you guys want to. But this is a new one that we think is going to be really good for any new listeners in Pino Farina who don't really know his music, to kind of get like a quick summary of what your music is all about. And we call this game Rapid Fire, and that reason why will be explained by Dan in just a second.
So we take a number of your songs, and you get pretty much 5 seconds, rapid fire succession, to explain the deep, impactful meaning of each song that we throw at you. 5 seconds.
That's right.
Of my songs?
Of your songs, yes. Yeah. So you're going to have a little bit to think about it, not much, just whatever comes into your mind first. And then at the end, we'll wrap it up by playing one of your songs. Does that sound fair to you?
Let's try. Let's hope I don't fail this miserably. Yes.
I think you'll do great. I honestly think you will.
Well, we'll see.
Dan!
He has no faith in me.
I kid. All right. You got the timer?
I got the timer. Just tell me when.
This is official with the timer. All right.
And go.
It cracks.
Oh, the innate sense of being
time.
Alone. Hey.
Fine line.
Parenthood. Like, just
time.
Being a... Yeah.
Say goodbye to Mexico.
Selflessness and
time.
Yeah. Okay. This is like one it's of over. The answers. What is it?
It's over.
It's over. That's a breakup tune, bottom line.
Time.
Ocean Deep.
Oh, oh wow. Loss. Time. Great loss. Oh man.
Okay. Quicksand.
One more.
Really fast.
One more.
Quicksand.
That's just a true love song.
Time.
That's what it's, yeah.
Beautiful. Okay. That was wow. Great.
I wanted to repeat one too. Just to see, like, if it threw you.
If I come up with something else.
Yeah.
Dang, that's a good strategy.
I'll try
we should
that next
implement
time.
That next time.
But
Pino, I think you did very well. I think you did very well for yourself.
I think it really needs to be like a one-word answer. It sounds like to me, just from the as quick as it goes. So.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We've had some people. Sorry.
Sorry. One more time.
Oh no! I like the song list that you chose. I like all, those are some of my faves. So that's cool that you brought those ones up specifically.
Likewise.
All right. So yeah. With that, I think we shall. This is, at this point in the podcast, play one of Pino's songs. Pino, let's let you decide, since you are the mastermind behind these tunes. Which song off of your album would you like to introduce the listeners to?
Well, actually, it's not one that you mentioned on there, Dan, but and it's one that I don't feel gets a lot of attention, is a song called How Much, and it was actually written and recorded back in the Kunsapaya days of things, mm-hmm. which if people know part of my history, that was definitely a big part of it. But that's, I love the song production-wise, and just... it's one of my favorites. So How Much, I would say. Yeah.
Perfect.
Okay.
Cool.
So you're listening to How Much by Pino Farina Band on...
The Underbelly Hours. New and improved in my basement.
Yeah, I don't know what we're going to do to replace the WRSC, but in my basement sounds pretty good.
In my basement. In Dan's basement.
In
the deep bowels
oh
of the
God.
Dick residence.
All right.
Sorry.
Stop.
What?
Thank you.
That was the song.
How much?
How much? By Pino Farina. Thank you, Pino. Lovely tune by a lovely artist. And, you know, well, to go back maybe a little bit to music later, since I know that
we have the scoop. Why talk about music on a music podcast?
Well, we have the scoop that Pino actually has a new song, but we'll make you wait a little bit more for that. For now, I want to kick things off a little bit with what the topic we started with at the beginning of this conversation, which was live streams. Because you are kind of the king of live streams, one of the kings that have come out during this quarantine, strange, crazy year.
Yeah.
So I guess to kick things off, I kind of wanted to start by asking, you know, COVID has been happening for like a year now. So how have you guys, you and the band, been both impacted by COVID and kind of gotten creative during this unprecedented time?
Yeah, I mean, so the band wasn't actually that busy before COVID. Like as a full band, we weren't doing a lot of full band gigs. I was doing a lot of duo shows with John Schiller, who was on with me on your show last time. So I think what happened was, you know, once COVID hit, clearly, like, we were all just kind of like, you know, what now? I think like every other musician out there, what now? You know, the whole industry is just still hit really hard and hasn't come back yet, clearly. So I think the streaming was just a way. I mean, the first stream I did, I was a deer in headlights. I remember I had never done anything live before on a social media platform, and it was quite scary. I'm not gonna lie to you. You know, as many times as you do play live shows or perform on a live stage with a live audience, but there was something about going live that was really scary to me, and I just I've gotten a little more comfortable with it, obviously. But, you know, the more you do anything. But it's just been the only way to really connect to a live audience is just getting those likes and hearts and comments and being able to engage with people, which I find actually to be a little different than performing a live show on a stage. Like here, I'm in my studio and I'm performing to a live audience, and I'm actually able to interact with individual people and their individual comments in between songs, and like kind of more personal. And I don't know, it's been kind of like this newfound thing that I don't think I'll stop doing once COVID is over, you know, and we go back to like live shows. I think I'm going to keep the live streams as part of like my thing, you know. It seems like such a great way to connect with people. So I don't even know if that was the answer you were looking for, if it was anywhere near where we started. It was kind of just, it's been great. And the fan base has grown, like, before March and to now. Like, I feel like I've just gained so much new audience, and it's translated to some live gigs that I was able to do over this summer outside with the social distancing and all that stuff. You know, I would play gigs before March, and it seemed like there was a handful of folks that would come out. And then, like, after March and the streaming, like, it just seems like there was just more people who knew who I was. And just, and of course, everybody's just eager to get out to live shows. So it was kind of like a combination, I think, of both. Right. But it was just, it's been a nice way to be introduced to, like, a whole new audience that would probably never have known who I am before the streamings happened. So it's been pretty awesome.
Yeah. And also, what's been cool to see is venues also participating.
In the live streams? Yeah, yeah.
That you just recently did a couple at Sohopt? Is that how you say
it? Yeah, Sohopt. Yeah, Sohopt. Yeah, so they're a local brewery in the area, and they've opened their doors to me in order to be able to do things. And it's cross-promotion, you know what I mean? It's like, hey, order some beer from them. They're making beer. They're trying to stay in business. Like, order some beer and then tune into the live stream and, you know, kind of make it like this event, you know, or this collaborative thing where, you know, for any local business and local musician to sort of like connect like that, I think it is awesome. You know, it's like just everybody's trying to help each other out. So, Yeah, I hope to connect with other small businesses or other venues. I mean, I did something for the Rock House as a venue out in West Dundee back, like, I don't know, 4 or 5 months ago, where they, you know, they just reached out and asked if they could sort of host the event, but I was still streaming in this studio here. Mm-hmm. And we just kind of you know, promoted it, and it was just kind of like, hey, the Rock House is putting on this show for their patrons that can no longer see live music in their establishment. So, yeah, I think I would love to do more of that, you know, I think, but right now I've got this connection with Soul Hopped, and they're so close to where I live, and they're just such great people, that it just feels more like a family and community thing at the moment. So I'm just kind of rolling with that, but they're great, great folks. And I think other musicians, that would be a great, you know, opportunity for other musicians to sort of like connect with their like hometown local restaurant or bar or whatever, and like try to like cross promote things like that. You know, mm-hmm. I think it's pretty important to support local businesses like that, mm-hmm. and local musicians. You know, it's kind of like one hand washes the other. Right. So.
Actually, interesting that we bring that up, because I know the Elmhurst Brewing Company was doing that a little bit with virtual open mic for a little bit, and I think a few okay. other bars as well, just this idea of having somebody there in the venue to perform and invite other people virtually to kind of collaborate with them as well. I also really like what you've said, Pino, about like the personalization. I didn't think about that too much until right now. The personalization of responding back to like individual comments as they're coming across a live stream, right? Because when you're sitting yeah. in a venue at a concert, you get the sense, the cool, you know, experience of obviously enjoying music with a group of people, but you don't get to necessarily connect one-on-one with the artist performing, right?
Yeah, most people aren't shouting out.
Right,
like
unless they're...
There are conversations.
Kind of,
or,
yeah.
Well, unless they're...
You know, a little too many drinks or something like that. But then it's... that's a different experience, right? That's like not a very welcome always experience.
Right.
So my question to you is kind of related to that. What platforms do you think that you've found to be the most effective at kind of communicating with people as you're doing your live stream? I know you do a lot of Facebook lives. Do you do any
yeah.
sort of YouTube or Twitch or anything like that?
I'm not really familiar with Twitch at all. That may just be a generational thing. I don't know. But I think I started on Facebook, and it seemed to just be comfortable for me. It was a comfortable fit once I kind of got into it, and I'm kind of like one of those types that just like when something's working for me, I just kind of like I'm just comfortable with that, and I don't
yeah.
like to too far out of my way. I did try some cross posting from Facebook, but what I didn't like about that was I was streaming on this platform, and I'm reading comments coming through on like Facebook, because that's where people were watching in that room, but then there's people commenting in a different room trying to connect with the performer, me, and I wasn't even seeing their comments or their their engagement. I wasn't getting that. So, and I only tried it like once, and I was like, yeah, I don't like that. Like, I want to be able to connect with everyone in one place. So I haven't really tried the Instagram lives. I know there's different apps or whatever. There's like Restream. There's a couple different ones
yeah.
where you can just stream from like this platform, and then it puts it out to like different places as you're going. But yeah, I haven't really experimented too much with that, just because I feel a disconnect, to be honest. So even though it might be better for me as far as like, or for any artist, as far as a reach goes, because you're probably reaching different people on different platforms, and it's like more exposure and all that stuff, I wasn't really focusing on that. I just like to be able to connect personally if I can. That's kind of what I feel is a strength, you know, that these streams give you. So try to really work with that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So
well, because you definitely have to make up for the fact that you are through a screen, right? So the personal communication is one of the biggest strengths, and people do really need to utilize that when they're using a live stream. Because I feel like sometimes people, and I saw this recently too, someone was doing a restream on Facebook Live, Instagram, and YouTube at the same time, but it
yeah.
felt weird because they would barely acknowledge the audience between songs, and it was, you weren't really sure if you were watching like a concert or like a practice session. And not to blame the artist, because they were just trying to increase their reach, but it's like you're saying, since it is virtual, you need to do something extra, I think, to get that connection there.
Right, for sure. Right. Yeah, and it's kind of weird to have that almost like VIP chat room that you can, that you're only discussing with, kind of cuts that thing off from other people.
Yeah.
So you're pretty much saying that mostly it's the artists that are investing in the equipment and they bring it to the venue, at least in your experience, that's what you've been doing.
In my experience from that Fall Fest thing, I know that there was a production team that was hired to go in and actually like set up for that, you know, and all my experiences doing remote stuff has been me bringing in that stuff. To be honest, you know, if I'm going to play at a local bar down the street, half the time I'm bringing in my own PA speakers and setting up my own stuff anyways, yeah. You know, I mean, so if you think about it from a musician standpoint, that's kind of already part of our gig, is to bring all that. So like for the establishment to even provide like live streaming capabilities, I think would also maybe fall on the musician too, is my guess.
Okay. You know? Well, then you think...
Unless it's a venue, you know.
Yeah.
Right. That's different though, a little bit.
Do you think then going forward, venues will at least be open to musicians wanting to bring in their own kind of like video setup if it's just consolidated to the camera?
Yeah, in relation to going back to just collaborating on promoting together and like getting, you know, gaining, like, so you've got the musicians' reach on their social media, then you have the establishment's reach of all of their patrons that have been and checked in into their place, and so you're kind of combining all that. I'm sure they wouldn't mind the publicity, the promotion, the, you know, it's all cross, you know, interconnecting. So yeah, I'm sure the establishments wouldn't mind, in my opinion, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that'll be fun.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
No.
I haven't seen many venues kind of gearing up themselves, except for maybe Cairo.
Yeah. Well,
Cairo totally
souped
up.
Right, and they were trying to raise money for basically what they thought was going to be shut down for a really long time.
And Andrew's already like a video.
That's true.
Guy, mm-hmm. a director. But I was you brought up something with that when we were talking about, you know, the equipment and investing in that. And he said something about like, yeah, it's you want it to be more than just setting up a phone on a tripod and hitting go live.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think, and this is just from what I've seen, I've also kind of took a step back from social media for a bit, but it seemed like live streaming was going down after the summer. There was like a little surge because things closed down again, but I feel like since, you know, November and December and into now, I've really only seen like you live streaming, Common
mm-hmm.
Allies.
Mm-hmm.
I've
seen a few cover bands do acoustic stuff.
Right. And still pulling in like great numbers, mm-hmm. like, you know, 2,500 to 3,000 streams per video. But a lot of the other local people we know, it seems like they kind of dropped off the streaming, and maybe the numbers were going down. Maybe the public were kind of losing a bit of interest, like the novelty of it maybe started dying off. So do you think that, part of it was because it was too many people were just kind of throwing up their phone and hitting record and it sounds like phone quality? Or do you think it was something else?
Well, I mean, I think that from my very first stream back in March, like you were saying, you're right. I mean, I think the very first one, and I had like a lot of folks sharing and Huntley Fall Fest, like I had some established pages that were like sharing it. I think that one initially had like 10,000 views on it, you know, which for me is like insanity. Like, I'm like, holy shit, especially being my first one and everything like that.
Right.
And the numbers definitely dropped down. I think people just at that time back in March and April, and, you know, it was just like nobody knew what to do. Everybody was just trying to like latch onto something and just like, oh my God, what is happening? You know, we're all stuck in our house. And then throughout the summer, I mean, people were doing live gigs. You know, I played more gigs this summer than, like, it was insane. I can't tell you. I mean, I was playing, like, rooftops, you know, at Dirty Nelly. I was just playing, like, parking lots. Mm-hmm. I was playing, you know, anywhere. And I was, like, super busy playing outdoor gigs. And I didn't stream at all for a while just because I was so busy with that. But I think... Then the winter came again, and I think people are. I mean, it's like last night. I'm just home, like not doing much. You know, it's like I should be streaming right now. Why not? You know, like,
mm-hmm.
It's just a way for me to connect. So, I think, yeah. I mean, if you don't really concern yourself with the numbers so much, and like for me, like I said, I'm doing it to keep that muscle going. I'm doing it to keep. You know, just to keep connecting with people, whether it's, you know, 15 or 50 or two or whatever it is, you know, I can't speak for why other bands like kind of dropped off in regards to streaming. But for me, like I personally enjoy it. I think it's really easy for me to just set up here. I've got my Pro Tools rig. I've got my microphone set up. I've kind of got a method, you know, and I'm still using my cell phone. Not to knock anybody who's using their phones to stream. I mean, it's like we all just have the equipment that we have. That's what we're working with, you know. I could use OBS, but I found that my audio, I don't like the audio using that, so I ended up going back. Like, I've tried so many various things over the months to try to make it the best for me and for the audience. And for me, audio is more important than video. For me, personally, as a musician, like... Mm-hmm. That's why, like, we decided maybe not to do a live performance via this Zoom or Skype call, because the audio quality, it doesn't do the musician any justice, you know what I mean? And so, you know, what I found is with my setup is I'm using Pro Tools, which is a recording software, and I'm sort of pumping that through my phone, you know? So when people are hearing me, you know, I'm using a nice microphone, I'm using like some reverb and some, you know, just kind of like making it comfortable for me as a musician. And so it sounds good for me and it sounds good for everyone out there. And if, you know, my image is actually reversed, it's a mirror image lately when I'm doing like campfire streams and stuff. And I'm like, I'm willing to deal with that, you know? I feel I would rather give people the audio experience and they're still connecting, there's still an image, I'm still visible and everything. It's not like awful quality, and but as long as I can put out musically and audio wise something that I feel proud of, then I think that's really the main goal and focus for me personally. So I don't know as far as the numbers go. I don't know, you can't really worry about it. It's like like any musician, you know, is somebody gonna like the song that I just wrote, you know? It's like, I mean, if you worry about stuff like that, then that's kind of stifling too. You know, it's kind of
100%.
I won't forget it. I'm not going to write anymore. You know, like, because I'm worried about what people are thinking about. It's like you can't focus on stuff like that. So
you're always going to have haters, no matter what you do. So
that's right.
Yeah.
Thinking maybe it could be also since, you know, there isn't the live aspect that. Recently, people are kind of almost clinging on to numbers more so than before, and like likes and hearts, because they aren't getting any kind of
applause or anything.
Yeah, they're not getting any real life reward. You know, dopamine. Good, like that felt good. You know that. Even if nobody like, says, you know, nobody's going crazy, but just like the applause of just that
of the
everyone,
the applause of the hearts.
Yeah, but.
I'd like to, if you don't mind, shift the conversation a little bit more, because you mentioned, you know, your collaborations a little bit, like with the So Hopped Brewing and Huntley Fall Fest and stuff, but I've also seen you doing videos with other musicians, and I'm curious, what has been, like, one of your favorite collaborations that you've done with musicians over this time, and how you started doing that? Because it's one thing to stream, right? You had to figure out all these different types of things around streaming. And then trying to release videos remotely with other people is another huge, like, pain in the butt to figure out. So, two questions. Which was your favorite collaboration, and how did you even get started in this cross-collaboration remotely, right?
Cool. Yeah. So back to this probably goes back to one of your other conversations about how the band dealt with things once quarantine happened. Was one of my favorite videos that I did was collaborating with our band members, and we did this one with all four of us, you know, on a screen together. But we were all remote in our own studios, in our own homes, and we did, you know, a cover of a Rod Stewart song, Forever Young, which is one of my favorite songs. And but we were able to do that. Like, I just sat here and recorded my part and then shared it with them digitally, and then they were able to, you know, record themselves and playing live. And then I, you know, I was, to be honest, I was laid off. I was on furlough for about 3 months around March, April, May. Mm-hmm. And so in that time, I learned a ton about how iMovie works and how, you know what I mean? So then I'm using my Pro Tools audio, basically making a mix of a song, as musicians learn how to do. And then I had to then learn how to use iMovie, drop the audio into that, and then create a video, you know? And it's like, mm-hmm. So there's all this learning that needs to happen. But so my favorite collaboration, I think, was the one with the band, but I've done some great stuff with some incredibly talented people that I'm so honored that were even agreed to work with me, to be honest with you. Nick Cox from Seventh Heaven and Dave Mikulskis from High Infidelity. I just did one with a girl out in New York who I've never even met before, but somebody mutual friend was like, hey, this person is super talented, you guys should do something, you know? And so we just did that thing, you know, where I would just record myself and then send it to that person. You know, it's just mm-hmm. this really a big learning process involved with making all that happen. But again, for me, it's all about connection and content and like staying relevant, I guess, at some point, because if you just drop off and don't do anything, then what, you know? Right. I mean, then you're not doing anything, right? So mm-hmm. The live streams were one element, and then the videos were just another form of staying musically busy and keeping my brain occupied with things other than how awful COVID is to the world and how awful so many other things that are happening in the world. It's just a nice, like, as a musician or an artist or a painter or a mechanic working on their car in the garage, it's like, it's just a way to, like, focus on something that makes you happy, you know? And so that's really what started the collabs. It's like, how do I just keep being creative and keep being musical, you know? Mm-hmm. So
I have a goofy question, if you don't mind, because I think last week on the radio, we were talking about, and my work, like, weird habits we picked up from 2020, just something that we tried to do that we never done before. I know that you took, obviously, learning how to live stream and video edit, like, that's so much of, that takes up so much of your time, but I'm curious if you also picked up, like, I hate how cheesy this sounds, we called it, like, a quarantine hobby. Like, did you start baking a lot, or did you, like, work on cars? Did you start painting, too, while you were at it, or was music mostly the thing that you focused on, to keep saying?
For me, I don't think, I didn't do much, I'm not really good in the kitchen, I'm not gonna lie.
You didn't bake banana bread? Like everyone was doing?
No, I mean, for me, it's just been, I've been just like spearheading, like with blinders on, with just the music thing, you know? For me, plus, I mean, I also have two kids that are, you know, and we were here in this house, like, locked up for a while, so we were just finding ways to, like, you know, stay busy with the kids and everything. But as far as like some new skill aside from like maybe video stuff and all that, unfortunately, a boring answer would be I don't really have any new things like that that I picked up, so I'm sorry.
No, that's fair. You had to learn so much, right? That's just this goofy question that popped into my head.
Yeah, I think the one thing would be like iMovie and editing video and everything that you had to learn to stream and all that stuff. Like, I think a lot of people listening should still be like inspired to still invest in that and pick that up themselves. Because, mm-hmm. like you said, you got to do everything nowadays, everything you can to stay relevant. And streaming and learning all the ropes of the video stuff and being your own like one man production show is proved to be very important throughout this last year, and I think it's going to continue to be very important. And yeah, I think it's just you could. I mean, it's inspiring to me. I feel like I need to go now and start watching tutorials on how to better produce and whatnot.
And I think what Dan said really quick is also super important. Like, it's never too late to start, you know, because this probably will be sticking around even after COVID. And I mean, honestly, let's be honest right now, who knows what's going to happen in the next year.
Right.
So might as well pick up those skills if you can.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you pick up any hobbies?
I baked a lot of banana bread.
You baked a lot of banana bread? All
right. How are you, Dan?
I started doing a lot of yoga.
Oh, I also got back into yoga. Yeah.
Shout out to Yoga with Adrian.
Hey, you watch Yoga with Adrian too? Oh my god.
That's my gal.
Dude,
that's my gal.
She's so good.
Making me toned and flexible now.
Yeah. Relax before bed. It's nice. It's a good thing.
Good.
I'm gonna have to try that. That sounds pretty good, actually.
Yeah, yoga. She's super easy. You know, she's all about the practice, incorporates the breath aspects.
Mm-hmm.
This has become one commercial for Yoga with Adrian, but you know, it's definitely knocked some bro-ness out of me. You know, I'm just always going to the gym and just like trying to lift as much as I could. You do get a little bro-ness.
Yeah.
Wafting in, and she was like, you know, just being able to do yoga is.
Mm-hmm.
Humbling and very beneficial. So
that's great.
Shout out to everyone. At least do some 20-minute yoga routine a day.
Yeah, it does help.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Maybe we can now switch over to music because we are a music show. We've talked a lot about.
We should plug another song too.
I know. Speaking of another song, this is the moment I've been waiting for because Pino has a new song called Elegant Touch, which he just recorded a video for us.
Wait, is this out? Did I miss
this? No. Okay. I don't know. Actually, we'll let him talk about it because he's the one who wrote it. But
yeah.
Go ahead, Pino. Yes, would you like to introduce this song?
Sure, yeah. So to answer your question, Dan, I wrote it about 3 weeks ago, and I wrote it on a Tuesday, and I had a live stream on Wednesday night, and I was like, you know what? I'm just gonna play it, you know. And it was like so brand new. It was like, what do I do with this song, you know? And I wrote it, and it's about just not being with quarantine and not being able to really like see you know, folks, your family, you know, your family members, like my parents, like people who are more high risk that you really don't want to like, you know, bring COVID into the house or whatnot and stuff like that. So. This song was kind of like born and written about that, like just about missing, you know, being able to like be with people that you really care about and that you can't be with because of this COVID situation. So, that's kind of what it's about really. And, so yeah, it's brand new essentially. And, we've already been able to get into, so I recorded it here in my studio, just me and my guitar, and I added a shaker to it. And then I played it for the band, and they just, in the same way we did the collaboration with that Forever Young video that I was, talking about, you know, John, the bass player, he put his bass guitar on it, and Mike Pupko wrote some guitar lines on it. We went into the studio not too long ago. We were all wearing masks, of course, and socially distant, but we got to record some full drums to the track. So it's going to be released soon, hopefully. So I'm really excited about it. I think it's maybe just because it's so new, I'm really excited about it, but it's definitely one of my new favorites. And so I hope you guys like it. Yeah.
All right. And here's the song, Elegant Touch by Pino Farina on...
The Underbelly Hours? In my basement?
There you go.
Alright, a little elegant touch here.
Footsteps in the morning, stirring up the dawn. Let the early light in like a thousand times before. It's gonna be a long, cold winter. Draw another line on the wall. Just tell me I can hope you tomorrow. It's hard to believe it. wasting all this precious time. And I can't take it, wasting all this time apart. It's hard to believe it, wasting all our precious love, love, love. Can't wait any longer, I'm aching for your elegant touch. Oh, bring you flowers and open up my heart, throw my arms around you like a thousand times before. Wanna build you a beautiful fire, kiss away all of your pain, carry your confusion. It's hard to believe it, wasting all this precious time. Can't take it, we're wasting all this time apart. It's hard to believe it, we're wasting all our precious love. Keep waiting any longer, I'm aching for your elegant touch. Stars before, and in the wake of this perfect storm, I'll be standing there, drenched at your doorway. It's hard to believe it, we're wasting all this precious time.
Quite elegant. It was a good song. So I'm sorry. I'll see myself out. I'm sorry, Dan.
Excuse you.
I'm sorry. Anyway.
Not here. Not on the new and improved Underbelly Hours.
Dang it. Actually, this is the place to be cheesy because we are uncensored now, so we can say whatever we wish.
You can be cheesy on the radio.
That's all radio is.
Yeah.
Insider secret. Anyway, it's a lovely, lovely song. And what's funny is before I heard you talking about it, Pino, I actually wrote down in our notes here that I hear touches of the influence of 2020 in it, right? Because there's lines like, you know, we're wasting all this time apart, I can't take it, you know, you can't see all the people that you love. So since you already explained the backstory to the song, though, it kind of leads us to the next question of, will there be more music coming out, or have you written music during the 2020 year that will be coming out soon?
Yeah, so I'm still working on an EP that we started recording before COVID happened. And then when you know, we were working on it, studio and this and that. And so we're still actually working on it. It's about 8 or 9 tracks. So I don't know if it's like a full release or an EP, but I'm definitely excited to get that done. I've got 2 more songs that I need to finish lyrics on. Vocal tracks and stuff like that on. And then we're still debating whether we should release the song as a full, like, album, like one single release and just drop it like that, or like this day and age. And that's maybe a conversation for another interview sometime. But like, with being an independent artist these days, like, should I drop like one song every month instead and just kind of like keep things fresh and exciting, you know, like an artist,
depends on
just to keep
the approach, I think. Depends on if you want to be Taylor Swift and just drop 2 albums at the stroke of midnight or whatever. I think it really,
yeah.
I think it could work either way, though.
Let's
honestly
get into it. I mean,
just for a couple of minutes, because I don't know. What do you think, Dan? I'll go after you.
I think that we are going back towards a singles generation, you know, and people will have their gripes about that, but it's not like it's new. It's not like it was always an album scene, you know, in the 50s and 60s. It was a singles game.
Singles scene, 100%.
You know, albums weren't the main seller. It was all the singles. And we're kind of going back to that now with the advent of the streaming giants, or rather just the streaming giant, Spotify, kind of squashing everyone else. And
I also argue TikTok.
All hail the algorithm gods. Yes, and
TikTok.
Sure, TikTok.
TikTok has been like
all those TikTok
exploding. Seriously, the sales of singles have exploded because of TikTok. People like 18, 16, 15, there was 4 under 18 or under 20 year olds on Forbes like most successful artists or people under 30 of 2020. Those 4 of them were TikTokers who blew up because of one song that people just started dancing to. Anyway,
but my last comment on that is, singles, I think, are great right now for maintaining the relevance in the moment right now, because people have very short attention spans, and it's a way to compete with, you know, everything that's coming out, because there's so much coming out every day.
So much is coming out, yeah.
Every day. But, you know, that is probably great for getting into playlists and into people's heads. Every time it's released, they listen to it a few times.
And people saved playlists on Spotify, right?
Right, but how well does it, you know, achieve a longer-lasting fan base that's super dedicated? Because, I mean, at least me personally, I love to sink my teeth into a full-length album. And that's, you know, usually how I really sink my teeth into an artist and follow them and get more invested, is because I'm listening to that album a few times on repeat, and then I get my favorites, and then I, you know... it's like, it's more in my memory of like, ooh, I should go back to that.
To play devil's advocate real quick before Pino answers, I will say that I think if an artist already has like a few or like at least one big album and then plays a singles game, I think then that's very beneficial, because then you have people, you can grab both ways, right?
Right.
By releasing the singles or by just, you know, people listening to your full album. Where I think it starts to fail is, I'm going to give an example of a really good Polish artist I got into recently named Michał Szczygieł. He's the guy who collaborated on that bonus Underbelly Hours episode that we talked about. Malinowy Mus is a song, and he's really interesting, but man, I get so disappointed because he has like five or six singles right now. They showcase very diverse aspects of his music. And after the end of the single, you're just left wanting more. You're like,
yeah,
this sounds like an intro track to an album, or this sounds like it should be going into another like song that's leading about something. But now, because he's signed by like Def Jam or something, he just has like six singles out. They're completely different genres, which is very cool because, you know, he can work in those genres, but there's no cohesive Shigio sound, you know?
Yeah.
So let's toss a question.
What are your thoughts on it?
What are your thoughts on the album versus single?
I mean, to respond to that a little bit, I guess, even when playing, I think part of this leaving an audience always wanting more is actually like kind of good, right? I mean, in my opinion, it's like, if you're like, oh man, like, I want, like, you know, so now you're just like aching for him to put something else out. So it's kind of working, it sounds like to me.
That's true.
I think just from an aspect of recording musicians, you know, especially independent, when you're putting all your own, you're investing everything you have into this, right? So you've got, let's say 9, 10, 12 songs that you've just spent months and months working on. And finally you're just like, okay, cool. Like, I'm going to put it out. And then you spend some time like promoting it or whatever, and you put it out, and then it just kind of like within a week or two, I feel like it'll just like fade away into the rest of social media oblivion, because it's just like you guys said, there's so much new stuff coming out all the time. Now it's going to take me another like 2 or 3 years to put together another, like, you know, at least, right? I mean, it's just, it's time consuming. It costs money. Like, as an independent recording artist, it's like, you know, I think I might get more longevity out of just doing singles, you know, in that regard. Like, you know, rather than just like having it all just fade away. And like for those true like song or those true music lovers who will just connect to a full album, which I get, you know, I guess the idea would be, okay, once I release all 10 songs, then it will be an album at that point, but it's going to take 10 months to get there, right? But I can make that a compilation, because they've been recorded as an album essentially. And so I don't know, I mean, we're still talking about it as a band and just trying to figure out what the best thing is for us. It's not the best thing for every band out there.
Yeah.
I think everybody's got their own story, everybody's got their own fan base, everybody's got their own, you know, views on it. But for me, I, you know, it's the Pino Farina band, so like I take to heart off like all three of their opinions on how we should go about this. Like, it's not just me, you know, and so it's a group decision, I think, and you know, we'll figure it out when we get there. But right now we just want to have all the songs finished, completed, mastered, mixed, mastered, everything, and then, you know, we'll figure it out. But it's definitely an open discussion at the moment. So, but I agree with both of you guys on both points, you know, as a full album. I mean, like, you know, a Neil Young album, you put that on, you just listen to the whole thing, you know, it's like, but nowadays I feel like people, the attention span of people is like, you have to keep getting their attention all the time. I feel like, not only them, but me, like, you know, I'm scrolling through myself, and it's like, you know, it's just trying to keep people's attention for as long as you can. And sometimes a 4-minute song versus like a 50-minute album might be the way to go in this day and age, you know. So
well, yeah, another cool thing that I just thought of with that approach, I dig it a lot, is because you make the album almost like a season, like a show.
Yeah.
You know, and they, you know, have to tune back every week or month to get the next episode, or in this case, the next song. That'll be great for concept albums. I'm already thinking of ideas.
Yeah.
You can make it like a whole experience.
That's
then.
That's cute. And like a little episodic.
Yeah.
Look at that. Yeah. Hey.
I think
just credit the Underbelly Hours when y'all take them.
Right.
And Pino Farina.
So, yeah, we're looking forward to the next season, then, of
the next
the Pino Farina band.
That's right.
I'm really excited about it, but, you know, and it's like, you know, and then you write a song like Elegant Touch, and it's like, oh, well, that's got to make the album, because it's like, we're so excited about it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we'll see. And as far as writing more stuff, I mean, it's just, it's hard for me to sit down and be like, I'm going to write a song today. like, I don't know about you guys, but because you're both musicians, so it's like, you know.
Yeah.
But then there's guys like in Nashville are like, they're like, that's their job. Their Monday through Friday job. They go in the morning and they write a song, like, they write every day.
Mm-hmm.
I've never been that way. If I had the opportunity to, that would be amazing. But, you know, the rest of life and work and family gets in the way, so you can't do that. But, yeah, I as a songwriter, I just write in the moment, like, when it's inspired, you know.
Yeah. I think there's a balance to be achieved with that. Like, I commend the songwriters in Nashville for having the discipline and commitment to, like, have to write something every day, even if they don't use it, because, I mean, then it's just more chances to stumble across something. But then on the double-edged sword of that is that you may fall into a songwriting rut where everything starts sounding
similar,
the exact same. You start catering towards expected sounds and expectations of, like, what the scene is doing, you know, standards like that. So, you know, it's almost easier then at that point to songwrite as a job, because...
Yeah, well, this is gonna, I feel like, let's end that there, because we can get into this whole, that would be a whole nother conversation about, like, the idea of writing for art's sake and writing for something that people can just, like, have happy feelings to, you know?
I'm just saying
like,
the discipline of at
discipline,
least
yes, correct,
writing
correct.
A little bit every day will maybe help you achieve that, you know, you have more opportunities then to stumble into that artist musing and revelation, and like, oh, psh, there it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, but, yeah, we don't have it. We're not on the radio, Adela. Right.
That's true.
This is untimed. We can digress and diverge.
I know.
But, yeah. No, but I mean, I don't do what I preach. I'm like you, Pino, where it's like, once I'm hit with that inspiration, that's when I buckle down and write. It's hard for me to just kind of write every day, and it's hard to get that discipline. But, yeah.
For sure.
Cool stuff.
Anything else, I guess, that you guys have coming up new that you want to, I guess, plug or anything like that?
Well, I mean, so I'm doing once a month right now. I'm doing those live streams from So Hopped, and they are collaborative live streams. So I'm asking, like, you know, some other talented musicians to join me with minimal, like, pretty much no rehearsing, because we're not getting together with social distancing and stuff. But, you know, so I'm doing that like once a month from So Hopped, and I'm still doing my live streams. I might even do one tonight. I kind of usually do like Sunday nights or Wednesday nights, but nothing's like, you know, etched in stone for that. And also, I mean, you know, now that I'm getting gig offers, but I'm sort of still like, hesitant to take them, like in heated tents and stuff. Like, we didn't really talk about that stuff so much. We kind of touched on performing over the summer, but I don't know, like, I'm still not comfortable with the heated tent idea and like playing in those kind of scenarios, so I'm not sure when my live gigs are gonna pick up again, aside from like in the spring when actually like the weather turns and we can actually play with some open air. That's, you know, that's kind of what I'm waiting for, but you know, I've got some gigs maybe getting booked in the May and, you know, in the summertime, so, but I'm not going to announce anything yet because I don't really know what's happening for sure.
Right,
that's fair.
But yeah, the live streams, I'm definitely on Facebook live streams at least once a week or somewhere around there, just kind of having fun and connecting with people. That's what it's all about,
and it comes across every time.
Oh,
you,
yeah,
you have some of the best live streams, and I think that's why you get...
Thanks for...
You know, you've grown so much over this time, you know, with a fan base, because people latch on to that authenticity and genuineness that comes through. And now I just forgot what I was going to ask. Oh, also, you got some brand spanking new merch, it looks like.
Yeah.
You got some of those nice hoodies and...
Dad merch.
Yeah, you got some merch.
You can keep yourself warm.
What's still available online?
It's pretty cool. So those merch stores, I have a kind of like this brotherhood. It's actually a fan of the bands that owns his own, you know, shirt business and all that stuff.
Right.
It's called Waste Up imprinted sportswear, and they're based out of Palatine. And so what we do is, like, they create an online store for the band, and we just give him all of the logos and the designs, which are dear friend. And so we don't have anything right now, but what I've been doing is just, like, right before Christmas, we did a two-week store, and we did, like, all the band's proceeds. We donated to, like, a food bank for the holidays, just to, like, try to give back to the community a little bit. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's I don't know, we're just, like, having fun with it, you know, right now. So I'll probably do another merch store in the springtime or summertime. And I'll definitely have some merch for, I'm going to load up on some before the live gigs happen, so that when I do play live shows, you know, we'll have some stuff at the shows to sell for sure. But yeah, so I'll be promoting the online stores when they happen, but I don't have anything planned right now in stone. So
cool. Awesome. Beans.
I have one last question.
Parting.
I mean, How do you keep all those songs in your repertoire? Like, how you have such a extensive song list, like, you're able to, you know, premiere new covers and stuff every live stream, like,
mm-hmm.
and pull out ones that you do sometimes better than the original artist, in my opinion. How do you just how do you keep up with that? Are you practicing these songs, like, you know, is there a, you know, today I'm practicing this set list.
Today's this 80s day.
And this day I'm learning five new top 40 songs. And because you still also make the covers your own, you know, and that's, it's not like you're just learning them straight, at least most of the time from what I've seen. So I just want to ask, how do you do it?
Yeah, I have an iPad that I use for lyrics mainly, because I'm like, my brain can't handle 3.5 hours worth of songs that I've never really played before. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times for these streams, like the last one I did was last Sunday, it was a couple weeks ago, and I went for over 3 hours, you know? So I'm just taking requests from folks. And when I'm playing in the little coffee shops and stuff, I just have an iPad, and I've just got, like, songs that I'm familiar with, you know? And so I just kind of, like, I just do, like, my version of a Michael Jackson song. Like, I'm just kind of, like, it's just what I remember about the song in my head, and then just, like, just sort of transposing it out through...
Yeah.
No, but it's just, I'm just doing my own thing with it. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of messing around with it. It's never perfect, you know. It's never the way it was intended to be by that artist. It's just like how I, you know, interpret it and just make it my own, I guess. But yeah, so the iPad is the secret weapon for three-hour shows like that, where you're doing songs that some I've never even played before, and somebody will ask me, and I'll be like, oh, okay, let me see what I can figure out here. And, you know, you just kind of like maybe stumble through the first part of it, and then get into it, and then just kind of feel it out, you know. So
that's where having a good ear comes in handy too, then, because you don't have to necessarily remember each song, every single last detail of it, but as long as you know, are familiar with music, you listen to a lot of music, you have the general structures in your head, that almost makes it easier to make it your own and put your own twist on it, because you're like, I know the general structure, but hey, I don't remember what this guitar solo is, so I'll just make up something of my own, for example, or whatever.
Yeah.
And I also think that just makes, you know, the performance more fun and real, you know? Anyone can just play it straight, but, I mean, part of the fun, and I think why people latch on to you and other streamers that do this, is because they're hearing something fresh and familiar at the same time. And that's, you know, what performers need to do, is that artistic expression, even if it's not their own song. So, kudos. I'm just, you know, I'm gushing. I'm fanboying out right now.
That's, I mean, I appreciate you asking, and, you know, it's, I do feel like that is a lot of what people really connect to with what I've been doing, is the, you know, I mean, literally, they were using words like penofied or, or whatever it is. I'm always like, every song, I don't know how it goes. I'm just like, something like that, you know? And so that's caught on when I'm doing, like, weekly streams for 2-3 hours at a time. Like, people that are watching and connecting, like, you know, they're coming up with these hashtags of stupid shit that I say. Can I say?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Dude, that's what's funny is that you're not on Twitch, but that's what they do on Twitch.
Yeah.
That's what they do on Twitch. So it's just cute that you have, like, the same community, but it's on Facebook.
On Facebook, yeah.
So, yeah.
It's wild. It's been great. Like, it's kind of a family and a community of folks that are just and the thing is, when you're streaming for like 2-3 hours at a time, you're not working with the script, you're not working with like really any roadmap. Like, a lot of times I'll just start with like maybe like 2 or 3 songs that I feel that I'm in that mood for, you know, tonight. Let's say like tonight I'm gonna probably stream around 8 o'clock, so I'll just pick like 2 or 3 songs just to kind of get the ball rolling a little bit. And then once people start to join in and start to ask for different things, and, you know, there's never a script, so I always end up, like, stumbling words and saying the wrong shit or saying, singing the wrong lyrics or what, you know what I mean? It's very loose, and it's very, like, alive, and it's fun. It's like hanging out, you know? It's like just not leaving your house and being in a social environment is really what it feels like to me, and I think that's what people watching feel like too, you know. Yeah. I mean, it's amazing, like, how many comments after, you know, the shows, the gigs, the stream, the gig, whatever you want to call it, when it's over, and then you look back at all these comments, like, people are just having fun, like, mm-hmm. It's a big part. It's crazy. It's so much fun. So, yeah, I'm loving every minute of it. So I'm gonna just keep doing it until it stops being fun.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And inspiring. And yeah.
I feel like that's awesome. A good place.
No, that's great. Yeah.
That's a good place to end.
Yeah, we're happy that everything you've been able to find a way to advance through all the crazy of the past year, and I am 100% certain that it's only gonna keep, you know, progressing and growing for you, and I can't wait to see what comes next.
Awesome.
Suggest everyone to stop being a loser and go check out Pina Farina. Check out his live streams, check out his album, and stay tuned for some new songs coming out. Pina Farina Band Season 1 or whatever.
Season 2.
Season 2, right?
Now. Yeah. Season 1, it's already out on Spotify.
And go buy some merch.
When it's out.
Go follow all the pages, including ours, because, mm-hmm. you know, we have egos that need to be stroked as well.
Right.
Speaking of, is it Pina Farina Music on most platforms, or Pina Farina? What's your handles again?
Yeah, I mean, it's really, so on Facebook it's Pina Farina Music. On Instagram it's Pina Farina 54, just because that's what it is. I don't really use that many other forms right now. It's just Facebook and Instagram for the most part. I do have a YouTube page that has. I do archive all of my live streams that I do, even the 3+ hour ones that are filled with a bunch of mistakes and stuff. They're mm-hmm. all available on YouTube. So I have like hours and hours of stuff on YouTube, including studio tracks, all the video collaborations that I've done over since March to now with all those different artists. They're all on the YouTube page. So that's Pina Farina. On YouTube, you can just find it like that. So thank you guys so
Beautiful.
Much for having me. It's been a blast to catch up with you guys.
Yeah.
I wish you nothing but the best for this new season and your new digs and your new studio down there and with the podcast and all that stuff. You guys are so great, and I hope we can connect again really soon. So.
Thank you, Pina.
We can't wait. Thank you so much for taking the time and joining us. It's been great. Even if we can't be in person, just to be able to talk to you through Skype.
And I think we could say this too, if it's not apparent already, we're both huge Pina Farina fans and of the music and of the band. So, like, seriously, go follow Pina Farina. You won't regret it. So.
All right.
Guys are awesome. Thank you.
Best wishes.
Tune in next week for some more music interviews. And if you like what we do here, talking to local musicians and talking about the scene, follow us at The Underbelly Hours on Facebook, Instagram, and a revamped YouTube that's still getting a little more vamped, but it's coming.
Check out our new account on Parler. Kidding.
Just, we don't have a Parler. We only have an OnlyFans. We don't have that either. Just kidding.
No, we do have an OnlyFans. It's my OnlyFans.
In any case,
I got one subscriber.
You're Dan.
You're Adele.
And this has been another episode of the Underbelly Hours
in my basement.
Boy!